tools. Let's do something. My name is Emma and I am the Urban Botanist. Today we're going to be talking about managing pests on our houseplants, and I'm going to sprinkle in some outdoor garden pests as well. But let me know in the comments where you are tuning in from, and let us know what grow zone you're in. And also let me know in the comments what type of pests you've been battling. I'm always curious to see what people have been battling and dealing with, and it'll help me also guide my conversation with you guys today when I talk about all of the different remedies that we are going to be discussing. So whether you're tuning in on YouTube or if you're joining us on Facebook today, please let us know in the comments where you are tuning in from. I've got my comments up over here on my other screen so I can see when people are popping in to say hello. And of course, as always, please feel free to leave your questions in the comments. I'm sure there's gonna be a whole lot of questions today, which I absolutely love. And feel free to type away and leave them there, okay? So let's get into it. We are going to be chatting about, of course, insects. And for those of you who are maybe waiting for us to go live on Facebook, just stand by for a few moments. We're having a little bit of a technical issue, but that is okay. But we're going to be talking about, of course, pests. And it's something that I really get just, you know, a little bit of the hairs on the back of my neck tend to stand up when I even start thinking about thrips or mealybugs or some of these things that, you know, we have issues with that I've had to deal with. And the truth of the matter is if you've got one plant, 10 plants, you've got an outdoor garden, if you are a horticulturalist and an amateur horticulturalist, even on any level, you're going to be faced with pests. Like, it's just part of the deal. You know, basically what we're trying to do with our houseplants is domesticate them, right? By bringing them inside. And insects have evolved to adapt to our indoor lives, our indoor homes. They've also evolved to become incredibly inconspicuous. So really, because these two organisms have co-evolved, when you have one, you get the other. And that's just the way it is. And it's not the end of the world. It doesn't make you a bad plant parent. Doesn't make you a failed plant parent. It just means that you're a plant parent, straight up, okay? So we're gonna be talking about a few things that I'm gonna be chatting about while I just wait for the Facebook to go live here. We're gonna be chatting about a few different remedies that I have for you guys. Not only will we be discussing how to actually identify some of these common pests that you see both indoors and outdoors, we're gonna also be talking about how to combat those pests, and more importantly, how to prevent those pests from coming back, because that's ultimately what we want. Preventative measures are always the best so that you can, you know, keep those pests at bay. So that's what we're gonna be chatting about today. For the most part, organic options. Options that are non-toxic and a lot of options that exist for you to use and create and make at home. So stuff that you probably more than likely already have sitting in your kitchen cupboard, stuff that you more than likely already have sitting in your medicine cabinet, lots of stuff like that, okay? So that is what we're gonna be chatting about while I just make sure that our Facebook is going live here. So stand by if you're joining us on YouTube. If you are joining us on YouTube, please let me know in the comments. I'd love to see who I'm chatting to today, where you're tuning in from, let me know. okay, so we're gonna go live on Facebook now, so no worries. All is good. It looks like it's coming together. All right, let's get into the juicy stuff, the juicy details about pests. For starters, options that exist for you that you can buy. You know, it's easy, one and done. You want to go out and buy something. Okay, we've got some options. This one may look familiar to you guys, and it's the sticky trap. You guys use these before? Let me know in the comments if you've used these sticky traps before. You can kind of see this one's been used, so you can see some of those little black spots. Those are some adult fungus gnats. Maybe we've even got a couple little thrips on here. Yeah, it looks like it. It's kind of a great way to get an idea of what exists what you're potentially battling. Because sometimes you're battling a pest infestation that you don't even know about yet. And you may be watering your plants, you're like, well, I don't understand, I'm watering them, I'm not giving them too much sun, I'm not giving them not enough sun, but there seems to be a negative reaction happening here. My leaves are turning yellow, they're getting glossy, there's different things happening, and you're not quite sure what it is. Sometimes what it means is it's time to take a closer look, okay? We have someone who's joining in on YouTube, Portia, who has thrip issue and it's driving her crazy. I am here for you, Portia. I've been battling thrips for, I don't know, a year solid. I swear they come in cycles, they come and go in cycles, and I can never get a full hand on them. To be honest, the pill that I've had to swallow is that you're never going to fully get rid of some of these insects, because you gotta think, they're so small, they're so tiny, and they go through these cyclical life cycles where they will maybe not be present in one moment, and then a month from now you have a whole bunch. So it's really just about the number one tip that I can give anybody who's dealing with any insect issue is persistency. You need to be persistent. You need to keep up on all of your methods, whatever your method it is that you're going to be using, which we're going to talk about methods. You need to be persistent with those methods. It doesn't mean that you're going to be using your insecticidal spray for a week and then, okay, they're going to be gone. No, it's going to be weeks and weeks, and maybe you get a week off and then you come back, and it's just going to be part of your regimen, part of your routine. And one thing that I love about houseplants, and what I love about being an urban botanist, we're all urban botanists, is, okay, for those of you who are joining us on YouTube, just get prepared to do this all over again, because we're about to go live again on Facebook, and I promise you it's going to be worth it. So those of you who are joining us on YouTube, we're going to do this all over again one more time. For those that are joining us on Facebook, okay? So. We are live. Welcome, welcome. Thank you for everyone who is here and joining us on Facebook. We had a little bit of a technical glitch. No worries at all. I'm excited to be here with you today. Leave me a note in the comments here if you're joining us. I always love to hear where people are joining it from, what grow zone you're in, and maybe let me know what you're battling. Let me know what pests you're dealing with. We have Portia who's joined us on YouTube. Hi again, Portia, and thank you so much for joining us today, who's been dealing with thrips. We're going to be talking about all of the plant pests today. It's something that I find, especially during the summer months, I deal with a lot more for whatever reason, probably because there's a lot more insect activity during the summer months. So feel free to let me know in the comments exactly. I've got them up here so I can see who is chit-chatting. Let me know where you're tuning in from. Let me know what you're battling, and let me know what you want to hear more about so I can steer that conversation towards you. But what we're going to be chatting about today, we're going to be talking about different options for you to actually fight these pests. We've got Ava, who has been dealing with spider mites. I got you, Ava. They are the worst. And for spider mites, I find that there's actually a lot of plants that are more prone to getting spider mites. I'll talk about those and how to potentially avoid those in your plant collection. We're going to be talking about how to identify these pests, which I think is so key and so important. Sometimes we're battling an infestation that we don't even know we have, right? So we're going to talk about how to actually identify those. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about how to manage those pests, how to kill them, how to get rid of them. In my experience, it's really difficult to completely and totally get rid of a pest infestation. Like, truly, to kill every single microscopic egg or larvae is near impossible. So something that you have to just accept, a pill to swallow, as being an urban botanist or as being an indoor horticulturalist, outdoor horticulturalist, is the fact that when you have plants, you have bugs. They just go hand in hand, they co-evolve together, and it's just part of life. Doesn't mean you're a bad plant parent, doesn't mean you failed at being a plant parent, it just means that you're a plant parent, okay? As I already mentioned, but I will mention again, My name is Emma, and I am the Urban Botanist. I am going to be chatting, of course, about plant pests today with Lee Valley Tools. So we are so excited to be chatting about that today. All right, so let's get into it. First thing that I want to chat about is some options that exist for you that you can go out and purchase. And I was kind of talking about this before when we went live on YouTube. But one thing that is a really common thing that people tend to buy and start using right off the bat, and maybe this looks familiar to some folks, and let me know in the comments if you've used these before. These are sticky traps, and Lee Valley Tools does carry these. And the version on Lee Valley Tools is the Forever Green Steno. These are so cute, honestly. Usually the ones that you can buy at other department stores, they're just kind of like these plain, boring little single strips, where the Lee Valley Tools ones actually has these really cute little shapes that they come in, birds and tulips and that. But these yellow sticky traps are fabulous in that insects are attracted to the color yellow. And they're, of course, really sticky. So adults that are flying around can get trapped on these traps. Now, I will say that these on their own simply aren't enough. They are a great way to kind of catalog or see what exactly might be flying around in your space. So you can see, okay, we've got thrips. Okay, we've got some fungus gnats. But chances are you probably already know what you're battling. These are great for capturing and killing adults. However, this should never be used just on its own. You always want to use a sticky trap in conjunction with something else. And the reason for that is because sticky traps are just capturing the adults, as I mentioned. And we really want to get to the root of the problem, no pun intended. We really want to get to the root of the issue, which is these adult fungus gnats, thrips, whatever it may be, are actually laying eggs in the soil of your plants. And I know that sounds disgusting, and kind of is. But again, it's all part of being urban botanists of our own, is insects come hand in hand with our houseplants. So that is something that I think a lot of people missed out on or skip, is that you have to get to the root of the problem. You have to get to where these insects are actually laying their eggs. And that's in our soil, on the leaves of our plants, even sometimes, especially thrips, they like to lay their eggs in, new, fresh, unfurling leaves. So we really want to battle those eggs, because that's just going to create more and more adults, of course, right? So we are going to talk about some options that exist that you can go out and buy. Easy, one and done, you can go buy it. I mean, I shouldn't say easy, one and done, because the chances are is that you typically end up using more than one option when it comes to battling an infestation of any kind. I personally do. I use beneficial nematodes, I'll use diatomaceous earth, I'll use some pyrethenes, I'll use lots of different things, because sometimes that combination is what can be the most successful, as opposed to just using one or something else on its own. So we're gonna talk about different options that exist, and chances are you can use them, several of them in tandem. Some you absolutely should not be using together, and I will discuss that. But I also have some, and mostly organic, all-natural remedies for you, so you can use them in conjunction with multiple other options. I typically stick to organic options. I do not use pesticides. You don't want to be using pesticides outside or, of course, inside. So I'm going to teach you guys a few options that you can DIY and make yourself. Chances are you already have a lot of these materials sitting in your kitchen cupboard or even in your medicine cabinet, okay? So I'm going to teach you guys one of my favorite solutions. I'm going to save that for the end, so make sure you stick around. I'm going to show you one of my favorite, easy and powerful insecticidal spray that you can make, and it's totally organic, non-toxic, okay? I'm going to talk about that. But let's go back to options that you can go out and buy. So this is one that exists that I've used many times, and this is called the Safer's End-All Insecticidal Soap. It is a concentrate. So what you end up doing with this is you pour a small amount into a water bottle, and then you dilute it. It's basically a soapy mixture. It has pyrethenes in it, I believe, which is a natural component. It comes from the chrysanthemum flower. And what it basically does is it paralyzes and kills insects, but it doesn't have a negative effect on the plants, more or less. So this is something that I recommend. It's easy to find. You can typically find it at your local home hardware or whatever it may be. You can find this pretty easily. So this is something that's an option for you. This is another spray that I've used, it feels like it's a lot more hardcore. Maybe it's just like the packaging that makes me feel like, geez, I'm really going ham with this. So I don't really use this all that often. Only when I have found that I've had a really bad infestation, when I go away to the cottage for a week and I come back and I haven't been on top of my regimen, and I see a really big cluster or bundle of spider mites or thrips, I'll use this. And this is a Dr. Green spider mite knockout. So it's for spider mites, but it also works well with thrips and that sort of thing. So this is something that you can go out and buy. And the last thing, of course, like I already mentioned, are those sticky traps. Okay, these are available on Fleet Value Tools. The other thing that I'll mention, and I kind of mentioned this already for the YouTube folks that are joining us, is that this, all of these measures that we're going to talk about today is not really like a one and done, you spray it on one day and then you're good. All of these measures, and the thing with insects is they go through cyclical life cycles where there's the egg cycle, the larval stage, the adult stage, you know, and they go through this cycle. So sometimes you may be managing the adult phase, maybe managing the larval stage, maybe managing the eggs. It's really hard to combat it all with just one spray. It really requires you to be persistent. And if there's anything that I can really hammer down through this session, is persistence. You have to keep on top of all of these methods. It's not going to be just one day of spraying and you're done. This is going to be a weekly thing until you're basically not seeing these pests anymore. And to be honest, chances are in a couple months from now, they'll probably come back. So it's really all about keeping on top of your regimen. It's about being a plant parent and checking in and making sure there's no funny business going on. You're not noticing any sort of insect activity. But we're going to talk about how to actually, I'm just going to see if there's any comments here on Facebook. We're going to talk about how to actually identify some of these insects as well. So we've talked about these that you can buy, which is great. Let's get into some of the more natural things that I've used and I found has worked. So one of those things is, where is it here? Cinnamon. Believe it or not, cinnamon, chances are you've got it in your spice rack. Cinnamon is a great antifungal option that you can sprinkle on the roots of your plants when you're repotting, sprinkle on the top of your soil. This helps to manage fungus gnats. For example, fungus gnats are those little teeny tiny flies that are flying around your house. They fly up your nose, fly in your mouth when you're mid-bite. They're so annoying. Let me know if you have fungus gnats, if you've dealt with them, because if you have, you know what I'm talking about. They are so freaking annoying. But fungus gnats are, for the most part, they're not super detrimental to the health of your plant, but really bad infestations, absolutely. What they do is they basically attack the roots or fungus that's growing naturally, you know, around the roots of your plant. So they eat fungus. That's where they get their name from. One way to manage fungus gnats is cinnamon. It actually works. I found that I've sprinkled cinnamon on a lot of my plants and I really don't have any fungus gnats. Mind you, like I mentioned, I use a lot of different measures. I use a lot of different things in tandem, in conjunction. So chances are that it's all of these measures that I'm using that are helping to mitigate and manage my fungus gnat issue. But cinnamon is something you can use, okay? So that's one thing that you probably got at home already in your cupboard that you can try out. Other things that I do for fungus gnats, for starters, beneficial nematodes. I've talked about this before on the Lee Valley Tools channel, but beneficial nematodes is a great biological option, meaning a living option. In that nematodes are a microscopic worm, basically. And that sounds weird and gross. And like, some of you are maybe like, oh, hell no, I am not doing that. We have someone who's joining in here, Carrie. I think this is Carrie May. Hi, Carrie, if you're joining in. She says that fungus gnats are the bane of my existence. I've tried it all, including cinnamon. Okay, Carrie, I'm here for you. I love a good test. I love a good competition for getting rid of something. Sometimes I feel like, yeah, I like bring it on. So anyways, for fungus gnats, what I like to do, another thing that works really well and it's super easy is I will just put like a layer, and I'll show you what you've done this side here, because I knew we had fungus gnats. I put a layer of gravel on the top of the pot. See this layer of gravel that I just put on the top of this potted plant? works really well. What this does, and it's super easy, an easy thing for you to do, is it prevents adults from emerging from the soil. Because eggs are laid in the soil, the adults emerge, they fly around, they fly up your nose, they fly into everything. They're so annoying. Also, what it does is it prevents those adults from going back to that soil and laying more eggs. So another really easy option, and like I already mentioned, use two things together. Use the cinnamon and the gravel. Beneficial nematodes, like I was already chatting about and went off on a tangent, also work. They're the microscopic worms. You can find them at your local nursery most likely, and you just apply it to the soil. You would never even see that they are actually worms. What they do is they eat the larva, they eat the eggs and of fungus gnats. So it's a great way to, like I already mentioned, get to the root of the problem. These sticky traps are going to catch the adults that are flying around, but they're not going to kill or manage the eggs and larvae that exist in the soil. So try the gravel, maybe try beneficial nematodes. Another thing that you can try using, which I'm going to talk about, I don't have it here with me. Unfortunately, I couldn't find any for this session. Obviously, word's getting out about what I'm going to talk about, but diatomaceous earth, D-I-A-T-O-M-E-A-C-E-O-U-S, diatomaceous. Diatomaceous earth, you can type in the first like five letters of that into Google and it'll come up. But diatomaceous earth is made of diatomes. Again, another organic, non-toxic product that you can use. And it's basically like this chalky almost substance. It's a powdery powder, white powder. And what that does is, if you look at it under a microscope, it's really sharp. It's like these sharp little small pieces. And how it manages pests, and it manages pests of all kinds, is it will cut the cuticle of an insect and essentially cause it to die. So diatomaceous earth is something that works really well for a lot of pests that live in your soil. Your fungus gnats, maybe you've got ants outside. The other thing, the only thing with using it outdoors is you could be potentially damaging those beneficial insects as well. Indoors, it's relatively safe to use. I put a layer of that on top of my soil, and there, then any sort of thrips or fungus gnats end up dying when they come into contact with those insects. Okay, so that's something that I recommend big time using is the diatomaceous earth. It works really, really well. Something that you something, however, that I will mention is you don't want to use diatomaceous earth with nematodes, okay? Because diatomaceous earth is going to kill your nematodes. And that's one thing that you don't want to use in conjunction with itself is the diatomaceous earth and nematodes. So just make sure that you're not using those two things together, okay? So for your fungus gnats issue, try that out. You'll probably have some great success with it, I promise you. Okay. Next thing that I recommend, these two things here that probably exist in your medicine cabinet, is isopropylalcohol and hydrogen peroxide. These two things actually work really well with infestations. I typically only use isopropyl alcohol with small infestations. I'll just take a Q-tip and swab, you know, scale, mealy if I'm seeing anything. But another thing you can do is dilute this into a spray bottle. You really, really want to dilute this. The key thing whenever you're making any sort of a mixture, and this is going to go for our DIY insecticidal soap mixture that I'm going to teach you guys how to make at the end of the session, is you want to always make sure that you're doing patch tests. So you spray a leaf, you wait a day or two, and you make sure that there's not any sort of negative impact, that the leaf isn't burning or having any sort of negative side effect, okay? So with alcohol, I usually use like one part alcohol, eight parts water. Like really, really dilute it, because a small amount of alcohol can truly go a long way in killing insects. And that's the same for hydrogen peroxide. Now, one thing that I know a lot of people do is they'll do hydrogen peroxide soil washes. And let me know in the comments if you've used this before. I'm just reading this in the comments here to see. Yeah, try out the nematodes. Carrie, that might help. And Linda says that she's, I've heard that a layer of sand on the soil surface prevents eggs being laid. Absolutely, similar to the gravel, a layer of sand will work very similarly. So yes, absolutely. And then Linda has also said, not putting your indoor plants outside and outdoor plants inside goes a long way for preventing problems before they start. Absolutely. That's kind of a big way for how our indoor plants get a lot of pests, is from bringing them indoors. We're putting our beautiful outdoor tropical plants outside during the summer. I know it's tempting to do, but you can run into a lot of problems there. But back to the hydrogen peroxide. Has anybody tried a hydrogen peroxide wash of soil? That's something that's pretty popular in my experience that I've seen a lot of people use. I personally don't do that, and I never have. And I'll tell you why. First of all, I'll tell you why people do use this. And again, a diluted mixture where you're diluting it into a big jug of water and rinsing it, basically washing it, rinsing it through the soil. And ultimately what that does is it kills larvae and it kills eggs. What that's also doing is it's killing all the microbes that exist in your soil. Okay, the important things, the healthy living things that exist in your soil that our plants rely on. So ultimately you're killing everything. You're just killing your soil. Your soil should be alive. We don't want it living with the bad things, but we do want it living with the good things. So in terms of hydrogen peroxide soil washes, I don't really recommend. If you've got a really, really bad infestation, that might be a good choice. But at that point, what I would ultimately suggest is repotting the whole plant. Getting rid of all of the soil that exists in the pot completely. You can do a wash or a dunk of the roots in a diluted hydrogen peroxide mix. That will kill any fungus, it will kill any eggs or larvae or anything that's kind of still hanging out. And then you can go and repot that plant with fresh, sterile soil. Okay, so if you're having any sort of big infestations and you're thinking about doing a hydrogen peroxide soil rinse or soil wash, try that instead. Okay, so I'm going to save my last options for the very end, which is going to be how to DIY and make your own at-home solution that is friggin' powerful and all natural. Okay, so that's going to be saved for last. What we're going to get into now is actually identifying these insects, actually identifying what these things look like. You know, I'm just gonna check to make sure that there's no comments from Facebook. We're gonna actually just check to see, but we're going to actually talk about how to identify these insects, okay? How to identify them not only by visual inspection and seeing the insect itself, seeing the pest itself. Sometimes they're not even insects, sometimes they're arachnids. But what we're going to also talk about is how your plants might be looking if there is an infestation. So one thing that is kind of like a big red flag for me is my poor orbifolia here. This orbifolia was absolutely perfect. Carrie's asked, how do you make sure your soil is sterile? Any packaged soil that you buy, unless it's been opened, you know, sometimes you can buy loose soil at your local nursery. Anything that's packaged is going to be sterile. It's very good. Okay. The Spider Mite brand spray is the Dr. Doom Go Green. Dr. Doom. Okay. But back to this orbifolia. I was so in love with this plant because it was literally perfect. It was like a show plant. It was honestly so gorgeous. And that's kind of the reality too of being a houseplant parent is, you know, I get these questions a lot is like, well, how do I get rid of the browning tips? And it's like, you're never going to get rid of them. And the truth of the matter is there's no perfect plant. All plants have imperfections. They just do. It's part of it. Nature is not perfect. If you want a perfect looking plant, get a fake plant. That's what I tell people. So while I am a little bit heartbroken, it's not the end of the world because it's a gorgeous plant. But this plant was infested with thrips. You can kind of see what thrip activity looks like is almost like a burn. It looks like the leaf is burning. You can actually see it on my foremost hair right here. You guys can notice that. It almost looks like a mosaic, sort of patchy. It almost starts out yellow. It's like this yellow mosaic dotted body looking right there really well. Sort of texture or pattern on the leaf And that's a big red flag. That's like red flag, alarm system going off, like get started on some options, remedies real quick. And honestly, identifying and recognizing pests on your plants is, in my opinion, a great way to engage with nature or engage with your plants on a regular basis. It's a great option instead of just watering, because as you guys may or may not know, the number one way that we kill our houseplants is overwatering. Because, you know, we get our houseplants, we're like so excited, we're like, oh my God, I love it. I'm gonna be the best plant mom, plant dad ever, and I'm gonna water it every single day. You don't wanna water your houseplants every day. You don't. Most of them don't need it. Mind you, in the dead of summer, sure, you might need to water a little bit more frequently, but for the most part, you don't need to water your plants every day. It's almost like this nervous tick or itch that we have to do. Something that you can do instead is check your plants for pests. Chances are they're hiding on the underside of your leaves. They're not usually hanging out on the top of the leaves because insects have evolved. They're smart. They know that they are at risk hanging out on the top of a leaf. So they typically post up and set up camp underneath the leaves of your plants. So especially thrips, they'll hang out on the underside of your leaves. So it's a great thing that you can do. It's something that you can, you know, check in on. Check the leaves. A great preventative thing that you can do is wiping your leaves on a regular basis. Wipe them down. Wipe them down with a really diluted alcohol mixture or a hydrogen peroxide mixture. You can wipe the leaves down. That's going to help prevent spider mites, thrips, a whole lot of nasty pests that can come, pests that can come around. Okay, so you can give that a try. But that's kind of a sure sign that you're having thrips. And we're going to get into now actually identifying some of these insects. But we're going to start with mealybugs. Okay, let me know in the comments if you had mealybugs before, or if you've never seen them before and you have no idea what I'm talking about. But I'm going to put up a picture of mealybug in just a few moments. But mealybugs are, I've had them several times. I've had them on my succulents. They're good in that they're easy to identify. I mean, look at these things. They're white. They're very obviously an insect. But also, in the next image, you'll see that they can look very unassuming in that they kind of just look like fluff. Has anyone ever seen this before on their houseplants? It looks like white fluff. It almost looks like little cotton fluffs. And you think, oh, that can't be so bad. What is this cotton fluff happening? Like, what is this? It is a red flag. This is, sirens are going off. Woot, woot, woot. These are mealybugs. These are no good. So identification, which is what we're talking about now. This is how we identify mealybugs. They're very, very easy to identify, at least. See, they're kind of like little white spots, little white tufts. They can be on the stem. They can be on the underside of leaves. They can be on the top of leaves. I actually went into the World Exchange Plaza here in Ottawa a couple months ago, and they have beautiful plants in display in their big lobby. And from a mile away, I saw just a huge mealybug infestation on what was a gorgeous monstera deliciosa, just all over the plant. And I went up to security and I was like, security, who manages these plants? I didn't bring my insecticidal soap with me, but that plant has mealybug infestation. He just looked at me like I was crazy. That's okay. I am. But they're easy to spot is my point. So all of these measures that we've chatted about today will help battle mealybugs. But I wanted to show you guys a picture of what they look like, and I'm going to show you pictures of the other really common houseplant pests so that you can take a closer look today, tomorrow, on your regular, during your regular watering and care regime, and see if you can identify some of these really annoying and really detrimental pests. So that was mealybugs. The next thing we're going to chat about is spider mites. And we've had a few people mention that they've had spider mites. And my goodness, are they ever annoying? So we'll talk about spider mites. And they can also be kind of hard to recognize. The thing about spider mites is they're hard to notice if you're not doing regular check-ins with your plants. If you're just kind of going on autopilot and you're going around, you're watering all your plants, and you're like, okay, mental checklist done, on to the next thing. You might walk right past these spider mites, and I've done it myself. I've literally done it. I have a gorgeous allocation metalhead, and thriving, beautiful, looking so amazing. But from a distance, it kind of one day started looking just droopy and sad because it was under attack. And it only took for me to go really close up and notice in the rib of the leaf, so the main vein down the center of the leaf, I noticed very thin webbing. It's not quite like, you know, any other regular house spider web. It's really delicate, dainty webbing. And the spiders are also really teeny tiny. And there's not just one or two. There's a ton. There's a lot. And this is another really great picture here is they're almost like a copper color. They're almost yellow, orange, and they're moving really fast. So that's, again, you want to take a closer look. Spider mites are something that, and this is actually something that I do for all of my houseplants. I take them to the shower. I take them to the shower and I hose them down. I hose the hell out of them. I hose them down. They're going down the drain. They're going down there. I do a really good clean of my shower too after I'm done. But that's a really good first step for managing any houseplant pests, any spider mites, mealybugs, grips. We're going to talk about all of them. But that's kind of my step one. But with spider mites, that's something that you truly have to keep on because they will come back. You miss one or two spider mites, they will completely recolonize your houseplants. So this is something you really want to keep up on, okay? So those are spider mites. That's how you identify those. Again, really thin, delicate webbing. It will completely encapsulate a leaf and they work fast. That's why it's so important to check in on your houseplants, right? These are living things that we're sharing a life, a space with. And for example, I had a Calathea ornata in my upstairs bathroom, and I don't have any other houseplants up there either. It was the only one that I had in there at the time. And out of nowhere, you know, I never really even did check-ins on it. But I, out of nowhere, kind of just started looking like sad. And I was like, what are you being dramatic about? What is going on here? And so I took a closer look and was completely covered in spider mites. No idea where they came from. That's probably another question that you guys have as well is like, where do these insects come from? Where exactly are they coming from? Like, they're not, how did they get to my upstairs bathroom when they never were there before? Of course, insects have legs, they have wings, they can come in on our clothes, they can exist in soil, they can come in from your other houseplants that you're bringing home. That's why I always recommend, and something I always do myself, I quarantine my houseplants when I bring them home. You all know quarantine now. When I bring a new plant home from any plant store, big box, local nursery, a friend maybe who's gifted me one, doesn't matter where you're getting your new plants from, quarantine them. Don't introduce them to the rest of your plant shelf or all your other plants are just like vibing and they're good because you don't know what could exist in the soil. You don't know what might be hiding underneath the leaf if you're not really diligent in checking to make sure that there's no funny business going on. But I quarantine that plant away from the rest. I do that for about 2 weeks so that I have a chance to actually monitor the plant itself. You monitor it to make sure there's plant business going on. There's only so much you can inspect in that 5 to 10 minutes that it takes for you to pick out a plant and purchase it in a store. Maybe you're really diligent in checking, and that's something you always should be doing is making sure you're not noticing any little webs or any little black or yellow spots or white fluffs. You don't ever want to bring home a plant, of course, that's infested because it's just going to introduce it to the rest of your houseplant. So I do the quarantine method, and I'll do a spray. I'll literally just hose it down in my sink. Water honestly does wonders. And then I'll do a spray with that DIY little solution that I'm going to teach you guys in about 5 minutes once we get through the rest of our identification of pests. So we're going to jump into grips now. The bane of my existence, okay? I've honestly been battling grips for maybe a year now. A year. Like, it's just, I've accepted it. It's part of my life. It's part of who I am. It's part of my identity. But they just don't stop. And it's like I already mentioned, you're always going to have pests with your houseplants. And it's not about completely eliminating them 100% because, in my opinion, that's just impossible. It's a goal you're reaching for that's unattainable. It's about managing them and making sure they're not completely destroying your beautiful plants, okay, and spreading to your weaker, younger plants, or making sure they're not going out fresh new foliage that's coming out. But anyways, this is how you identify thrips. And in my opinion, why they are one of the most destructive is because they're kind of hard to identify. They're really difficult to notice. Like when I was up at a cottage, I had my mom come water my plants for me. And she's like, oh, this one looks yellow. It doesn't look happy. And I'm like, probably has thrips. And I said, take a closer look, see if you can notice any insects crawling around. And she's like, no, I don't see anything. I'm like, they're probably there, but whatever. I'll deal with it when I get home. And yes, it was thrips. They're very obvious to the trained eye, but truly, as soon as you see them once, twice, the trained eye, we can all get trained on it in our own way. Once you see them and you recognize them, you'll always recognize them. This is a young thrip where they're kind of like translucent in color. They're almost yellow. These are young adults where they're not fully mature yet. Adults will be black and a little bit easier to see, but I'm telling you guys, these are so small. They are visible to the naked eye, but this is how tiny they are. Like, they're teeny, teeny, tiny, and even this picture makes it look big. But if you're noticing kind of that burning look, maybe you're like, okay, I'm watering properly. Like I said, I'm not too much sun, is not enough sun. Like, I'm doing all of the things. It's time to take a closer look. This is another great picture of, it doesn't look like the end of the world. It's like, oh, it just kind of looks unhappy. Like, almost like this mosaic pattern is appearing on the leaves of your plants. This is thrip damage. And this is no good because they spread fast. And how this plant kills, or sorry, how this pest kills your plant, similar to the rest, is by sucking out the nutritional juices from your plant. So they've got this long, sleek proboscis, is what it's called, their mouth part. It's almost like a straw. And it basically sucks all of the nutritional juices out of your plant and ultimately kills it. So that's why it's starting to get that yellow color. These little sort of brown spots you can see on this leaf, it's very unassuming. It's just like a little random spot. But if you're noticing these things because you're checking in on your plants on a regular basis, take a closer look. See if you can recognize any of those juvenile, teeny tiny little thrips scattering around. They're more than likely on the underside of the leaf of your plant. Another thing that you might notice is little black spots. That was back in the day when I was kind of new to the world of horticulture. That was something that I didn't know how to identify right away, was I knew what thrips looked like. I knew what adult thrips and non-adult thrips looked like. But I was noticing black spots on the underside of my leaves, like teeny, teeny, tiny little black spots. And what I now know, because you're always learning in this hobby, as I'm sure you guys all know, my fellow gardeners and growers, I learned that that's thrip poo. Of course, beautiful, amazing, another reason to hate them, but it's another great way to identify that thrips are present is insect activity, whether they're eating, whether they're pooping. That is now a sure sign for me. Sometimes I don't see the adults, I don't see the immature, sleek little sort of yellow colored thrip. But I'll see their poo, and I'm like, great, there's thrips. So I'll get right into treating them. I will quarantine that plant straight away to make sure that it's not spreading those thrips to everything else. Okay. So let's get into the next one that we're going to talk about, which is scale insect. And I had someone mention it here already. Linda says that scale is the bane of her existence, and my next bay leaf tree will never ever go outside. Yeah. We learn the hard way sometimes. Scale is, honestly, in my experience, my, I don't know if favorite is the best word to use, but it is my favorite pest to get because I actually find they're pretty easy to manage and that they don't fly, to my knowledge. They don't fly. They don't really move around that much. They're pretty sedentary. They, you know, just kind of work their way up a stem. But the thing about scale, and a lot of people send me pictures of their plants, they're like, I don't know what's wrong with it. There's this like sticky stuff on the ground. That's called like the honeydew. That if you're noticing sticky residue or almost like like a sticky residue, like I don't know how else to describe it. That's kind of forming either on your plant or around the floor that your plant might be situated in. That is a really great indication that you have scale. And it's time to take a closer look, right? It's always about taking a closer look. So take a closer look. And the thing about these scale is they're really unassuming. Like, look at these things. They drop their sticky juices on everything. Linda on YouTube is telling us, and it's so true. But they're very unassuming, and especially on, you know, a ficus plant, ficus elastica, where the stem of the ficus is really bumpy in nature. And that's, of course, an evolutionary adaptation that these insects have so brilliantly taken on to be very unassuming and to camouflage in with their environment. You got to think, at the end of the day, these are evolving living organisms as well. They're doing their thing. They're living their lives. They're just a pest for us. But they literally look like little tiny, very unassuming brown bumps, and they exist primarily on the stem of your plants. You don't really see them on the leaves so much. They're more a stem pest. So you'll see them kind of forming in clusters. And why I said they're more or less easy to manage is what I do is, honestly, you can just take your fingernail and scrape them all off and dispose of them. But you can just do a little swabs with alcohol, hydrogen peroxide, wet a paper towel or a cloth, and just wipe them all off. They're pretty easy to manage. So if you have scale, the number one thing that you got to do is identify them. Identify that you even have them, because they do work quickly, just like most other pests. And if you've got a really bad infestation, you want to get on that quickly. I've seen some really bad scale infestations. I myself have only had like spots of them here and there, and I've eradicated them easily. But when they're really, really bad, you're going to have to think about, you know, something that's more of a spray or, you know, like a larger treatment kind of deal with them. Okay. So that's scale. And the last insect that I'm going to talk about is aphids. Aphids are something that you can get inside and outside. Usually chances are, and whenever I see ants in the house, I'm like, not because of the ants, but because typically aphids hitch a ride on the back of ants. They kind of are this symbiotic species that love to hang out together. But an aphid looks like this, to kind of give you an idea. They're kind of cute, but you know, I won't say that because I'm sure people are triggered by seeing the sight of this aphid. They also have that long proboscis, that long straw that they use to suck the nutritional juices out of your plants. They work in numbers. Like, they will completely cover your indoor and outdoor plants. They're brutal. This is another great reason for why you don't want to put your beautiful indoor plants outside and then bring them inside, which we're going to actually have a video on that in the future, shortly actually, in the next coming weeks, to talk to you guys about how to properly bring your outdoor plants in, if that's something that you're doing, right? The steps to take to, you know, ensure that you're not bringing in these pests. But these are aphids. Chances are you have them outside. If you have them inside, you want to get on that really quickly. And like I said, all of these measures that we've chatted about work well for these. But this will bring me into the last part of this session, where I'm going to teach you guys how to DIY and make your own powerful, natural insecticidal soap. Okay, insecticidal spray. So, the measurements that I'm going to be using is for 1 liter of water. Okay. So what I'll do is I'll make this mixture, and then I'll pour that mixture into a smaller spray bottle to use, so that I can spray it on, and I know that those measurements are correct. So what you're going to want to do, get yourself pen and paper, and you can write these ingredients down. This works so well for your indoor and your outdoor plants. Okay. It's great. You're also going to want to make sure that you're doing a patch test, of course, like we already talked about, to make sure that you're not going to have a negative effect on your plants. And you maybe if you are seeing, you know, burning or anything like that, it just means you need to dilute your mixture a little bit more. But I'm just reusing this old water jug that I have. This is 1 liter of water, okay? So for 1 liter of water, what we're going to be needing is, first things first, baking soda. Not baking powder, not any other sort of powders, baking soda. Baking soda is what you're going to need first. This is a natural product, again. So it's a great thing to use. In fact, you can just sprinkle baking soda in a lot of your outdoor gardens, and it has a really great impact on managing pests, and even can work as a fertilizer. But what we're going to do, first measurement of baking soda, is we're going to do 2 teaspoons of baking soda. Okay, so you guys can write this down, or this is a really, really good mixture. Teaspoon number one and teaspoon number two. 2 teaspoons of baking soda. Okay. The next thing that we're going to use is neem oil, which is something I haven't chatted about yet because I was saving it to the end. Neem oil is another really great natural product that you can use for not only killing existing infestations, but for preventing them. This is something that I spray regularly on my houseplants, and it prevents spider mites, it prevents thrips because they don't like this type of oil. It can be kind of tricky to find. It's really like thick in nature. It's almost like a butter. Almost it's very viscous. It's like, or non-viscous rather, it's super thick. So what I do is I will put this in a spray bottle, I'll add a couple drops of dish detergent, ideally a natural dish detergent, because that will help to emulsify the oil or mix the oil into the water, and I'll give it a good shake. And I find that works really well. Another thing that I've heard of people using neem oil for is actually diluting it into their watering can and watering their plants with the diluted neem oil. And then that gets into the vascular system of the plant. And then that ultimately wards off pests. So there's multi-uses for neem oil. However, if you don't have neem oil, you can't find it, you don't have any, you want to just use what you have at home, you can use any type of vegetable oil. Believe it or not. So sunflower oil also works great. Vegetable oil will work fine. And the amount that you're going to use is 1 teaspoon. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. Neem oil just smells like, I don't even know what, I can't compare the smell to anything. It smells like, it's not even, but let me tell you, this stuff works really well. So smelly or not, neem oil is the bomb. Let me know if you've used it before, if you've had success. I really, really recommend it. Okay, and this is coming, this topic, this live stream is so well placed in my life because I have a really bad thrip infestation right now. Like, seriously, they just seem to be everywhere. They're just popping up left, right, and center. So I needed to make a new mixture of this solution. You can call it whatever you want. This is a secret solution. That works super well. So I'm going to add my neem oil to my container here. 1 teaspoon of neem oil or any vegetable oil. Okay. And then the last thing you need to add is 8 to 10 drops of a dish detergent. And essentially, like I already mentioned, this is just going to help to emulsify this mixture. I'm just going to add. And lastly, we shake it up. Shake it up, put it in your spray bottle, and you're good to go. So this is a really great DIY insecticidal soap mixture that you can easily make at home. You don't have to go out and buy the stuff. You can, chances are you already have something at home that will work really well for you. So like I mentioned, this is a 1 liter of water. You're gonna do 2 teaspoons, okay, of baking soda. 1 teaspoon of neem oil or vegetable oil. And then lastly, you want to add 8 to 10 drops of ideally an organic, if you can, or a natural dish detergent soap. And that's going to help to emulsify the actual mixture or mix the mixture. And I can see now this mixture is really good and mixed. nice homogeneous solution. That was chemistry from high school's coming back to me. All right, I'm going to open it up to questions. I'm going to read through the questions here and see if I've missed anything. Okay. And let me know in the comments what you've got questions about, okay? I'm going to read through them, and I'm going to spend the next 10 minutes or so, 15 minutes, getting through your questions. So let me know if you've got questions, and I'll do my very best to answer them for you, okay? So we've got some Facebook questions that have come in. What are the best solutions for pests on edible plants indoors? So anything that's edible, this is indoors or outdoors, you always want to make sure that you're not using pesticides. You're using a natural solution. So something like this would work great. This DIY solution that we just made here today will work perfectly. You can use neem oil. That's a natural material that you can use. You can use beneficial nematodes. It really depends on what the pest is. But this works really well on just about everything, right? This was enriched fish water that I picked up at the farmer's market. It was pretty awesome, honestly. Okay, another question that's come in. I hear a lot of consideration about how these chemicals will affect the plants, but nothing about how they will affect pollinators. Absolutely. I did mention this at the beginning when we were live on YouTube, but not on Facebook, so apologies that you missed that there. 100%, you do not want to be using any sort of pesticide on your outdoor plants. Honestly, like, just don't do it. There's so many other better options that exist out there for you that won't affect our important beneficial insects, especially our pollinators. So one thing that you can absolutely ensure that you're avoiding is using any of these mixtures on your flowers. Spray them on the leaves, spray them on the stems, use it on the soil, so that it's not going to affect pollinators that are visiting the flowers on these plants, okay? Typically pollinators are visiting our flowers. So want to make sure that you're avoiding using any of this on your flowers, and that's a great way to ensure that that's not going to affect our pollinators. Okay, that's a great question. Okay, let's see. Thanks for joining, Portia. We're so glad that you were able to join in. And for those of you who are maybe tuning out now because we're at the questions, I encourage you to stay because there's always so many great questions and they lead to really fabulous conversations. But I will let you guys know that we do have next week is our upcoming live stream with myself. And it's going to be all about fall and late summer foraging. And we're going to have a guest speaker with us who will be teaching us. Her name is Tawny Simpson. She is the Forager Bee. She is a professional forager. She's gonna be talking all about how to identify and also cook with local varieties of indigenous species of plants and fungi. So make sure that you tune in next week for that. All that information will be on the Lee Valley Tools Facebook page and also on my Instagram page at The Urban Botanist, okay? So let's get through some of these questions. Ava is asking, how often can you use this spray mixture? Now, like I already mentioned, that patch test is going to be important, but the other thing you wanna do whenever you're introducing any sort of a new product, whether that be fertilizer, whether that be a spray, whatever the case may be, you really want to ensure that you are monitoring your plant, okay? So that maybe you're using it, maybe you've got a really bad infestation. I will use this every 2 or 3 days. I don't do anything daily for my plant. I always give them a break in between, no matter how bad the infestation is. And it also gives time for that mixture, whatever it is that you're using, to work. Okay, you may be noticing that, oh, the thrips are still there like a day later. Just give it a day or two. Okay, so I would recommend every 2 or 3 days, depending on how bad your infestation is, but always make sure that you're monitoring your plant and you're not noticing that the leaves are turning brown or yellow or they're getting crispy or having any sort of a negative reaction to that solution that you're using, okay? All right. Okay, Ava's asked, and is it safe for picky plants like calathea? Another thing you're gonna have to check out. My calatheas are actually pretty resilient. I don't know why they are like not like your regular calatheas. Everyone's houseplants are different. So you know, my plant may be a lot more resilient than yours. So just do the test. Can be really picky. One thing that I've done with some of these solutions is I've sprayed them on and I've left them for like 20 to 30 minutes so that I know if it's made contact with an insect, it's had time to have its impact that it needed to have. And then I'll bring that plant over to the sink and I'll hose it down and I'll spray it off so that that residue isn't just sitting on the leaf of the plant, right? So that's something that I would recommend. And another thing is too, with this mixture, I can even see now it's sitting there for a couple minutes. Every time you use it, you have to give it a shake. Every single time, okay? So if you've used it, you put it down, a couple days from now, you're gonna go use it again. Just make sure that you're giving it a good shake. And that should honestly be for anything that you're using, okay? You really wanna make sure that you're emulsifying and mixing up the mixture, okay? So make sure that you're mixing, you're shaking, and doing it. Okay, what else do we have here? I've read that you should rinse neem oil off after using it on your leaves. Is that necessary with this mixture? So I haven't ever rinsed off neem oil, but having said that, I'm diluting it into water. I'm diluting it into my spray bottles for that. It's a very diluted solution. Whereas if you were using, you know, direct neem oil onto your plant, which I would recommend using, you always want to make sure that you're diluting that solution. You shouldn't have to do that, but all plants are different. It depends on what plant you're using it on. So do a test patch, okay? See what the reaction is. Okay, let's see these questions here. Okay, looks like I've got through most of them. I can't exactly scroll through the YouTube comments, but I can just scroll. Alrighty, well, let me know if you do have any more questions. Leave them in the chat. I will make a point to go through and answer them, type them out in the actual comment section, okay? Thank you so much for joining me today. And my name is Emma, I'm the Urban Botanist. Thanks for joining us on the Lee Valley Tools YouTube channel. We will be having many live streams coming up, so make sure that you are subscribed on YouTube. Make sure you are following us on Facebook and on Instagram. We are full of awesome free resources for you guys to continue to grow your green thumbs. And like I said, the next upcoming workshop is all about foraging. I'm so excited. There are just so many different amazing edible plants and fungi that exist in our area. We're going to be talking about all different types of edible species, so be sure to tune into that. That's next week. And we will see you in the next video. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thanks for coming.